Welcome to worship at First Presbyterian Church of Gainesville, Florida. We are glad you're here, and we come expectant that when we gather as a community of God, as a church, that God moves here, that God does things in us, calls us together, and calls us to His mission in the world. I hope you were able to get a copy of our worship guide, either when you came through the back or through Gordon Hall. If you didn't, you can grab one at any time. Our goal with giving these out is to empower you to be involved in worship. Worship is not something we just observe, but it's something that we're involved in. And on this very special day, this All Saints Day, it is an important day to be involved in worship. Today is the day that we remember those who have passed before us, and it is also the day that we're putting into a month that we call Remember November, where we are trying to reclaim some of those things that we have lost during COVID, some of these things that have been taken away from us, and we're partnering with All Saints Day to remember those that we lost during this time. We have carnations in the back of the room. If anybody wants one of these to indicate that they lost somebody during this service, I carry one today to remember two of my seminary classmates that I lost during the pandemic. So it doesn't have to be a family member. It can just be somebody you know, somebody you want to remember. And so if you didn't get one, please head back to the back. But if you'd also like to go incognito a little bit, that's okay as well. This allows you to make the decision of how you want to do this. On the back of our worship guide is a list of announcements. I'm going to highlight just a few of these things, but make sure that you know, you read through them all at some point so you know what's going on in the life of your church. Today is the last Sunday to order pies in our fundraiser for our Montreat Music Conference in the summer. So if you would like to order a pie, please fill out your order and drop it in the offering plate, and we'll make sure that you are included. Some of you have told me that at times it is difficult for you to hear in this room. Our lead sound engineer and I are going to work on sound this Wednesday, November 9th. And if you would like to come and help us, we would like to have some of you here. I think we're going to gather around this room, spread out, go in some different places, kind of get a feel of what are the particular challenges with working sound in this room, and hopefully we can make it better. So if you would like to take part in that, be here at 3 on Wednesday. We'll have these doors out there open so you can come right in that way, and it will be a good, helpful time for us. We have a tradition in this church known as Concert for a Cause. It's when we do different kinds of musical concerts in order to help out with some challenge that is going on in the world. This fits with our mission statement that includes the words, meet human need. And next Sunday, November 13th at 4, we will have the Gainesville Community Band, directed by R. Gary Langford, present a Veterans Day concert here in the sanctuary, and there will be a punch and cake reception in Gordon Memorial Hall immediately following the concert. If you have any questions about that, Mitch is probably the best one to reach out to. We have decided that this Advent season, we will be going through the Advent devotional, The Promised One. If you would like a copy of that, please touch base with our office. They are in limited supply, but they are $5 each, and we think it would be a good thing for all of us to do together. The coming of Advent in a couple weeks also means it's time to decorate the church in that special seasonal way. If you'd like to be involved with that, please touch base with Marilyn Foote. Her contact phone number is in the worship guide, but basically the main day for it is going to be Monday, November 21st at 9 a.m. So touch base with Marilyn, be here on that Monday, and it will be great to have us involved in that. It really looks special as we head into Advent. Let us continue to worship the Lord.
Please stand for our call to worship. Hear the words of our Lord. I am the Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end, the first and the last. I was dead, and behold, I am alive forever and ever. I have the keys of death and Hades, because I will also
Before I begin with our confession and pardon, I just want to give a note of praise. Today marks our final day as far as hosting Family Promise. For the past 2 weeks, you all collectively have come together to help families get back on their feet, out of homelessness, and into their own homes. And so if you contributed, if you prayed, if you cooked a meal, if you greeted somebody at the door, thank you. Thank you so much for being the hands and the feet that Christ has called us to be, for being an agent of change. I also just want to spotlight two friends, Fred and Lisa both, for just taking on the yeoman's work of literally just, for the past 2 weeks, owning just this avenue that's before us. So thank you both to Fred and Lisa. When you see them, make sure you thank them. We couldn't have done it without them or the likes of you all coming together as one body. Join me in our time of confession and pardon. For the sake of peace and unity with God and each other, while trusting in the promise of grace, let us confess our sins to God and to one another. Join us in our corporate prayer, followed by a time of silent and personal reflection. Holy God, you see us as we are and know our inmost thoughts. We confess that we are unworthy of your gracious care. We forget that all life comes from you, and that to you all life returns. We have not always sought or done your will. We have not lived as your grateful children, nor loved as Christ loved us. Apart from you, we are nothing. Only your grace can sustain us. Lord, in your mercy, forgive us, heal us, and make us whole. Set us free from our sin and restore to us the joy of your salvation, now and forever. Now, O Lord, transform us as we continue our confession in silence. Hear the good news. Who is in a position to condemn? Only Christ. And Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. Christ prays for us. Anyone who is in Christ, they are a new creation. The old life is gone, and the new life has begun. Know that you are forgiven, and be at peace. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel.
Let us now prepare our hearts for the reading of God's word with the prayer of illumination. Let us pray. Pour out your spirit upon us, O God. With your word, enlighten the eyes of our hearts that we might live in hope through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Today's New Testament reading is Romans 5, 1 through 8, which can be found on New Testament page 154 in the Pew Bibles. Please hear the word of the Lord. Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand. And we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope. And hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. For while we are still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. Indeed, rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person, someone might actually dare to die. But God proved his love for us in that while we still were sinners, Christ died for us. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. On this All Saints Sunday, and first Sunday in our November Remember series, the hymns and anthems were selected to celebrate the saints of all ages, to remember those that have died, and to point to the victory we have in Jesus. Sometimes an anthem can have greater meaning when we know the context in which it was written. My hope is that sharing the following information will help give an understanding of why this anthem was selected for today, as well as connect us more deeply to its message. I Will Rise was first performed by Christian artist Chris Tomlin. This particular arrangement of the song by Capital University choral professors Craig Courtney and Linda Hassler. As they indicate in the inside cover of the sheet music for the anthem, one of their colleagues, a professor to many singers in the chapel choir, suffered a tragic loss in her family. Her husband's sister and young nephew were the victims of a brutal murder. The tragedy was sensationalized by the news media, thereby intensifying the family's loss and grief. As one of the arrangers writes, though there is seemingly little one can say or do to bring comfort in circumstances such as these, I asked if there was anything I could do to help. In response, my colleague asked if any choir members might be able to sing at the funeral. Before I could ask them, some of my students contacted me offering to sing at the service. I Will Rise was a piece requested by the family of the victims and in turn prompted this arrangement. I did not know the piece and would not likely have chosen it but for these circumstances. I now can't imagine not knowing it and not choosing it. We have sung it in countless and varied settings, a funeral, a music educators conference, concert halls, churches, and throughout our recent concert tour to South Africa. End quote. Today, as the First Presbyterian Church Chancel Choir sings this anthem, we are reminded of the great tragedy people face across this world, but also the hope and community we have in Christ.
Thank you. We now invite you to a point in the service where we hold space for a lesson dedicated to all of God's children. At this time, we invite any children or all children of God who feel comfortable coming to the front for a special children's message. Afterward, you'll return to sit with your families. We have one more friend making their way up. Oh, can you scoot over just a smidge?
No.
You're just a little close. All right. Well, good morning. I don't know if you've heard so far in the service or noticed, but today is a special Sunday.
Remember November.
And today is All Saints Sunday. All Saints Day falls the day after Halloween, so it actually was on November 1st, which was Tuesday. But churches all across the world celebrate All Saints Day this Sunday or last Sunday. And so we're celebrating it today, and it's perfectly fitting for it to be Remember November, because we remember those who have gone before us on All Saints Day. We remember the believers of the family of God and that are in heaven. Do you know any saints? Some of the saints from the Bible. Yes, Simon?
The ones that are in your picture.
Yes, Simon already knows what we're going to talk about. So he's going to give us some clues, I'm quite sure. But some of the saints in the Bible are Saint Peter and Saint John. And there's plenty of others that we read about who were followers of Christ. And they are the people who follow Jesus all through the ages. And I'm going to tell you more about that. But before we get there, I wanted to show you this. Does anyone know what this is?
A picture book.
It's a photo album, correct. It's a picture book. And in it are pictures of people in my family who are saints. They were followers of Christ who now have gone on to heaven. And I'm going to tell you about a couple of them. Simon, I'm going to ask you to come sit down here near your brother, please. Thank you. So, the first one I was going to show you and tell you about is this man right here. This is my Grandpa Hugh. And he was a dentist. I have another picture of him with me. He was a dentist. And he was a good man. He loved God and worked very hard every day until his final days as a dentist. He even spent some of his vacation time going to a different country and helping clean the teeth of people who couldn't see a dentist. And I'm going to show you one more member of my family. This is my Grandma Jackie. That's Shane with her in the picture. This is my Grandma Jackie. She was very funny. She liked to have fun, and she liked to throw parties. And she always made sure that her grandkids, me and my cousins, all knew how much she loved us. I often look at pictures of my family, those that have gone on before me, to remind me that I'm never alone. I always have them with me in my heart. I even have someone in here. This is my Grandpa Ed. I don't remember him, but I knew him, and he knew me, and he loved me. He died when I was a baby, so I don't really remember him. But I have another book with me. Does anyone know what this book is?
The Bible.
That is, it's the Bible. And I also like to look at my Bible. This is actually, yes, it's a first Bible. And did you know that just like in my family photo album, there are members of the church family in this Bible? There's saints in here. On this page, we learn about Abraham, who was a follower of Christ and is a saint. And on this page, we learn about Moses and how he helped free the Israelites and followed God. And the last one I'm going to tell you about are Jesus' disciples. And those are some of the ones that I had mentioned before. I had mentioned James or John or Matthew or Simon or Thomas. There's all sorts of saints who all followed Jesus. But you know what's so cool? Just like my family members followed Jesus, the ones in the Bible followed Jesus, and they are all saints and members of not just God's family, but our family, because we're part of God's family. And that's pretty wonderful. It means that the Bible is kind of like our own photo album, too. When you look through the Bible, maybe the Bible that you have doesn't have pictures in it, but you can picture it in your mind what your family members in Christ look like. And today we celebrate all of them. Will you pray with me? Congregation and choir, will you join us? Dear God, thank you for all the wonderful saints who followed Jesus down through the ages. Help us to follow their good examples and remember what a blessing it is to be in the same family of faith. We ask this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Our Old Testament reading and preaching text can be found in Psalm 100. If you want to follow along in the Pew Bibles, that is on Old Testament page 552. Psalm 100. Make a joyful noise to the Lord, all the earth. Worship the Lord with gladness. Come into his presence with singing. Know that the Lord is God. It is he that made us, and we are his. We are his people and the sheep of his pasture. Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise. Give thanks to him. Bless his name. For the Lord is good. His steadfast love endures forever, and his faithfulness to all generations. This is the word of the Lord. Do you ever wonder about what we do here week after week? Why do we come here every week and gather as a body? Why are we also on the internet and on television? We are here for a singular purpose, aren't we? We do this because we are convinced that we are creatures that were created to worship God. That our core identity, when you get down to who we are at just base part, we are created to be in relationship with our Creator God and to worship Him. So it makes sense that we would read Psalm 100 at the start of this service as we are remembering those who have passed on from this stage of life. We are dealing with conclusions. And Psalm 100 itself is a conclusion. It concludes a section of Scripture that celebrates the reign of God. In the last century, this was a really popular chapter for people to memorize. Many people in their youth, whether in confirmation or Sunday school, memorized Psalm 100. And the first memorial I did as a pastor, it was for a woman that wasn't really involved in the church, but as a child, she had memorized Psalm 100 in Sunday school, and her family asked, could we use that as the focal point of the service? Even though she had memorized it years later, they said she could still recite it perfectly. In the worst of times, As we question and go through stages of grief, it is fitting to worship God. This isn't asking us to deny hardship, to overlook deep things that we face, but it's asking us to pull towards God, to come near God, to move towards God, regardless of what we're facing. Notice in the text today, there were no conditions placed on this call to worship. It isn't limited to times of joy, to times of hardship, to times that are somewhere in the middle. It is right for all times. But today, when we are considering it as we're entering into a time of mourning, either mourning ourselves or mourning with others that are going through things, this is a good thing to remember, a good focus for us. This week I thought a lot about how I face challenges in my life. And one of the things that stood out to me is I gravitate towards extremes during hardship. Sometimes when I'm going through things, really challenging things, everything seems dark. It doesn't seem like I'm ever going to get out of this. This is just how it's going to be forever. In my mind and in my soul, there is little hope. During other challenging times, I think, well, you know, other people have got it worse than me. They've experienced hardships that are a whole bunch worse than this. Each of these perspectives have their own problems. The gloomier one takes God completely out of the situation. It denies God has the power or the willingness to heal. But even more tragic, if this challenge never goes away, it denies God can bring good out of my life. It denies that there can be anything good unless this is healed and taken away. If I get stuck in this mode, I devalue life. Surprisingly, the less gloomy one has its pitfalls as well. Often, it's just covering our pain by not walking into it and trying to just say, well, you know, other people have it worse than I do. It avoids going into something, to grasping how hard some situation that we're dealing with is. When I'm in this mode, I try to deflect my pain and not engage in the reality. I'm not thinking about others. I'm not thinking about anything. I'm avoiding is what I'm doing. How about you? What do you do at these moments? Do you ever go towards extremes? I bet you do. Worship calls us out of ourselves. It calls us to recognize the God that reigns over us and the situations that we face. It calls us to see the world more in line with the way that the God who is over the world sees it. In Psalm 100, all of the nations were called to praise our God. This is so important to recognize. It puts it in context of the loss we are facing is not a loss just all by ourselves. We're not isolated. It is a loss that we are called to within community, community with God and community with the world around us. We're not alone as we worship. If today was an actual memorial, it would have stories and memories of the one who passed, interspersed with the thoughts and understandings of what this scripture has to say to us. But you see, today we're not remembering one person who passed. We're remembering a lot of people that did. We remember those who died early in the pandemic, before the vaccines. Do you remember back what that was like? If you knew anybody that died in that period, when the restrictions were the greatest, when maybe we got to have a brief outdoor service at the graveside, only the closest family and friends were there, and even then, they had to be local. The lifelong best friend that lived out of state, they couldn't be there for that. We also remember those that were lost during a later peak, when what we expected to be a better time ended up being anything but the sort. When airline tickets had to be canceled and family members who tested positive just couldn't attend. And then we remember those who died in the best of pandemic times. with lowered restrictions and the ability to gather. But even in those days, the experience was less. There were some that still couldn't make it at that time. Some that maybe were trying to come from overseas. Some that couldn't make it because their job was too intense at that time. And then there were people who for sure would have been there. Nothing would have stopped them. But they'd passed earlier in the time. We remember all of those today. When we worship, we are invited into God's presence. We don't enter His presence fearful. We experience God from a place of love and peace because we have a relationship with this covenant God. This isn't the God that we can do anything for. This is the God who emphasizes the relationship between us and Him. And because of that relationship, He invites us to be with Him, and worship is one of the best ways we can be with Him. One thing that I think is important to realize, to remember during this, this is a psalm written in the Old Testament. It's prior to the new covenant with Jesus, but even though it will live into what it is more and more when Jesus comes. But God is offering this psalm to Israel and to the nations around them and to the world. And that would have been very foreign, very confusing to them at that time. That despite how they saw it, that they were special and set apart, God was always in the business of calling the world to Himself. This is a poem. And for many poems, those of you that have studied them, you know that structure can matter as much as the language, as the words themselves. It's that structure can often be the thing we miss, whether it was written in English, if it was written in another language or another culture, it just adds a bunch more complexities. And unless somebody points it out, we can miss those things. I would have missed what the focus of this whole psalm is. This whole psalm rotates around its center, and its center is, know that the Lord is God. In their commentary on the Psalms, Dennis Tucker and Jamie Grant say, this is the structural and theological heart of Psalm 100. Approaching this God is based on the fact that He and He alone is the one true Creator, God, and King. It's not to just intellectually know Him. Remember, Satan and the demons know God in that way. But it comes from a whole life devotion to this God, this King. Experiences like we are remembering today are the kinds of encounters that will send us back to our core beliefs. This awful thing that happened, that rocked our lives. At that point, we often question, is the one that claimed to be our rock, our fortress, is He who we really thought He was? Is God worthy of our hope and devotion? Or have we bought into something that is less than we've been led to believe? It's fine to have those kinds of questions, especially during these times. But notice how, despite whatever we're facing, Psalm 100 is unwavering. This is the Lord. This is our God. Perhaps the loss of the person you are remembering today creates all kinds of spiritual doubt. Maybe you're asking, God, how can you be good if this happened? If you are there, don't let go of these questions. Don't silence the pain, but also don't move away from worship. This is the activity that restores us to the knowledge of God in our lives. I forgot my carnation. I left it over there, but it mourns two friends that died during this time, neither of COVID, but COVID may have played a part. Both of these people that I remember, they were classmates of mine in seminary. They were people of joy and good spirit. One was an older woman that, despite having some very hard things happen in life, was full of joy. She loved to dance, and just love poured out of this woman on everybody. When I was in seminary, the song Happy by Pharrell Williams came out. Maybe some of you remember and know it. This woman was convinced that it was written for her. And all of her classmates, we agreed. We thought, yeah, I don't know if he knows her, but he totally right on with who she was. She died at the all too young age of 67. The other was very young. He was funny. He was a community builder. He brought all of his fun and tech wizardry into his youth ministry work. I imagine his students adored him. But there was a dark side. And in a sad moment, that dark side brought his life to an end. We have quite a variety of experiences bringing us here today. Some of us have been deeply crushed by the loss that we're mourning. For others, your experiences in the pandemic have been less impactful. Regardless of where you find yourself, the psalmist calls us to a place of worship, into a centering about who God is and about how He acts as our shepherd. If you're one of the ones who has been crushed, the God of the universe invites you into His presence to experience His goodness. And He isn't inviting you alone. He is inviting a whole bunch of others from all over the place. He's going to shepherd you along with His other sheep. He's going to take care of you and them. You will experience His grace and His goodness, His steadfast love, and we will worship. And as we do, we will understand more of God's steadfast love, a love that doesn't come and go, a love that gets it right at all times, in all places. And we'll share this with the world as God does His work in us and the world around us. If you are a person who has been crippled by a loss during this pandemic, turn your focus on the one who is known as God. You're going to mourn, but worship while you mourn. Meet God in your place of pain. If you're a person that has been spared a traumatic event during this season, turn to the God that is known. Join Him in His mission to shepherd the nations, many of whom are deeply wounded. See their hurt and their pain, and see yours as well. And see if God's steadfast love won't heal what is going on in their lives and in ours. We will move to a time where we recognize those saints in our church that passed in the coming year. Joe Ballister. Carol Crevasse. Arthur Kluge. Marion Broadaway. Janet Percival. Linda Wynn. Ertella Coffey. Carter Gilbert. Peggy Weigel. Kenneth Durance. Marilyn Hairston. Curtis Ball. Norma Sanderson. Lynn Dinkler. Mildred Evans. Emily Hoyer. Ruth Lukowski. Helen Ballister. Lois McGrady. Dalton Birch, John Herbert, Edwin Stoltz, and Miriam Kimball. Let us pray. Eternal God, we bless you for the great company of all those who have kept the faith, finished their race, and who now rest from their labor. We especially thank you for those that meant so much to the people that are part of this service, in person and virtually, whom you have now received into your presence. Meet us in our mourning as we go forward without these who are so dear to so many gathered here. Help us to believe where we have not seen, trusting you to lead us through our years. As this pandemic winds down, help us, through your power, to reclaim and redeem so many things we have lost. We pray for the families and friends of the estimated 6.6 million people who have died so far. Guide them to meet you in their mourning. In this pandemic, but use this journey to continue your work of transformation within us. Guide your church to recommit itself to the world around us that is always in need of you. Let us not forget the war in Ukraine, praying for the people and doing what we can do to support the impacted. Bring it to an end and limit the suffering. We recognize that our lives are also but a moment, and we ask that you bring us at last with all your saints into the joy of your home, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Let us now stand as we affirm our faith together with the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
If you haven't so already, please pass the fellowship pads down your pew so that everyone gets a chance to sign in.
Thank you.
Now let us continue with the words that Jesus taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
We have people in our congregation that this was not a difficult service for. We have others that this would just rock to their world because they're dealing with stuff. If you're dealing with something, if you want to process anything that happened today, or just what it looks like to have a relationship with a God who is worshiped but offers so much more. One of our elders is on duty, Sarah Hinton. She's walking up here this way. She would love to talk to you. Also, if it's time for you to put your membership with this church, we'd love to have you in that way as well. Sarah will talk to you about it. If you're a college students, we'd love to buy you lunch. Head through Gordon Hall into our serving room in the back corner. Follow Scott. Scott's always heading that direction. And have lunch. We would love that. God calls us to worship not for Him. God knows who He is. He doesn't need anyone to tell him. He calls us for us. He brings us into relationship with him. And he calls us to understand who we are. And as we worship him, as we follow him, we work out our junk. We're healed. We're transformed. We never finish that phase, not in this stage. But today we are celebrating and remembering several who have. If you need to talk with me, if this is a little heavy for you, if you need to talk to me anytime this week, don't hesitate. I'm your pastor. the rest of the pastoral staff is open as well. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine round about you and bring you hope and bring you peace. Amen.
Become part of a community that seeks to glorify God, to make disciples of Jesus Christ, and meet human needs. Join us at First Presbyterian Sundays at 8:30 and 10:55, or watch us on My 11 every Sunday morning at 9. We welcome you. Come and see.